It's such a joy and a delight to have you join us for today's broadcast. I trust that today's broadcast will be a blessing to you. Why don't you sit back, relax, and please don't change that channel, and let us see what God has to say to us.
Unity is not going to be instantaneous. It is going to be something that we fight to obtain and we fight to keep. When you learn to thank God on credit, He will open doors and make ways. If you're thinking healthy thoughts, health is your portion in Jesus' name. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he.
We have to start serving God with our gifts, with our talents, with our time, with our treasure, understanding what really matters, faithfully serving Him.
Verse number 17, 2 Timothy 3, verse 17 in the Message translation. Through the word, we are put together and shaped up for the tasks God has for us. Through the word, it is through the word of God that we are put together and shaped up for the tasks that God has for us. Say amen, somebody. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 18 in the Classic Amplified. And all of us, somebody say all of us, means that this, all of us are included in this. As with unveiled face, because we continue to behold in the word of God, as in the mirror, the glory of the Lord, are constantly being transfigured into His very own image in an ever-increasing splendor from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord who is the Spirit. Say this with me, please. Say, the Spirit of God uses the Word of God to make me more like the Son of God. Let's say it again. The Spirit of God uses the Word of God to make me more like the Son of God. Let's say it one more time. The Spirit of God, He uses the Word of God to make me more like the Son of God. Thank you, Lord. Lord, help us like only You can. We give You praise and glory. You are wonderful. You are a way maker. You are a provider. You are a sustainer. We appreciate You and we love You. We magnify Your name. Thank You for all You are and all that You do in Jesus' name. Amen. Paul said in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23, he said, may the Lord sanctify you wholly, W-H-O-L-L-Y. Holy means totally or completely. And he went on to describe what our whole beings are, spirit, soul, and body. I think it was last week that I said that, you know, having more information about a thing optimizes my use of that thing. If I choose to take the time to learn more about my iPhone, I will be able to maximize its function. So many things my iPhone can do that I don't know. And so my use of it is handicapped. That's just how life is. The more I know about me, the more I can optimize and maximize what God has called me to be, who God has called me to be, and what God has called me to do. It is important that every believer understands that God's will, God's desire, God's purpose, God's plan for your life is not a cakewalk. It's not automatic. That's what many of us don't understand. We underestimate the fierce opposition that we have in accomplishing the will of God in our lives, whether it's in our homes or in our character or our morality. That there is a strong, organized, conniving, methodical, Paul calls it the wiles of the devil, that's carefully arrayed against us, whose mission is to thwart all that God intends for us. No wonder that the scriptures uses words like soldier or militant or army. The mental disposition we have, if we're going to be who God wants and do what God wants. Jesus said the kingdom suffered violence, the violent take it by force. In other words, there has to be somewhat like a violent side of me. It can't just be a lily washed lamb, nice. No. Because so much is at stake. If I'm going to be, and if I'm going to do, who God wants and what God wants. Say amen, somebody. It is in this spirit, I believe, that Paul begins to enlighten every believer, basic ingredient that you need, that I need, that we need, in order for our lives, our homes, our businesses, our destinies may reflect what God wants. He lets us know that the word of God is imperative to be used by God in order for us to be shaped and made to be and to do the tasks that God has earmarked for us. In other words, without the word, I will be limited. I will be handicapped. I will be unable to do what God wants. I must always understand that. The power of the word, the importance of the word, how crucial it is for it to make me. In order for me to fully understand it, I must go down to some basics. First of all, we must understand that everything is nourished from its source. Everything gets sustenance and nourishment from its source. The scriptures tell us that when Adam sinned against God, he suddenly realized that he was naked. The question every inquisitive mind must ask is, how come he did not know, because he had all his senses intact before he sinned, how come he did not know that he was naked before? Because before the sin, before the fall, he was clothed in God's glory. Sin came, the glory lifted, the man realized he was naked. The man did what most of us do when we mess up. We struggle to be self-righteous. We try to fix the mess in the spirit of self. We do all we can to try to cover our shame and nakedness. So you know what Adam did? He went to the fig and cut the fig from his root and tried to cover himself and his wife, and it was not working. Because what was wrong with the man was wrong with the fig. The man was naked because the man was cut off from his source, God. The fig was not working and it was withering because the fig was cut off from his source, the soil. Because anytime I am cut off from my source, I will begin to wither off and die. In order for me to fully understand this, I must understand that are comprised of three parts, like the scriptures teach: spirit, soul, and body. I'm a spirit, I have a soul, I live in a physical body. My physical body is what gives me the privilege to be able to function in this physical world. I must understand that my physical body is time sensitive, that it is a dash between two dates, that I'm not, if the Lord tarries, I'm not always going to have this opportunity, because before God put his breath in my body, I was not alive. So my body really is clothing for the real me, which is my spirit. My soul is the interface between my spirit and my body. It is via my soul that I'm able to convey whatever I receive spiritually and disperse it physically. My soul, my mind, my will, my emotions, my intellect, my imagination. We talked about the soul last week. Amen. And how the soul wise unto salvation. And how the word of God prospers, preserves, heals, protects, and delivers my soul. Because my soul is the conduit with which I'm able to birth physically whatever I have received spiritually. Let's go a little deeper. Let's look at James chapter 1 verse 18. Look at this to underscore some of what we are striving to describe. James, look at what, of his own will, talking about God, of his own will, he begat us with the word of truth. Of his will, he begat us with the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. So I am begotten, not my body now, my body, he begat my body through from the ground, but he begat me, the real me, from the word of truth. So I am a product of God's word. So if I am going to be sustained and I am going to be nourished, it has to be by the word of God that God used to begat me. Are you hearing what I'm saying to you? So it's much more than just a good book. It's much more than just a great book. It's much more than just a motivational book. It's all of that. But the word of God is the lifeline for the nourishment of that part of me that is the real me. Say amen, somebody. Because it's that part of me that is the real me, is how God begat me. So if I'm going to be nourished, I can only be nourished by the word of God. Here, James calls it the word of truth. James is right, because God's word is truth. We see that in John 17, 17 in the NIV. Let's look at that. John 17, 17. Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. God's word is not just truthful. God's word is truth. It is the yardstick with which we must measure truth. One of the things that the child of God will face is the principle of the philosophy with which he or she must govern or drive his life or her life. How must I govern my life? Do I govern it by culture? Culture is what everybody's doing. Do I govern it by tradition? Tradition is the way we've always done it. Do I govern it by reasoning or logic? Logic is how reasonable it seems to do it. Or do I govern it by emotions? Emotion is how it feels right to do. The problem with culture, tradition, emotion, and logic is that all of them are products of man, and man is a product of the fall. Say amen, somebody. We all know that just because something is being done by everybody does not make it right. Oh, we know that. That was the time slavery was legal in this country. Almost every white person. Now, you know, nobody wants to even admit they're racist. Then, almost every white person owned a slave. Culture, it's amazing how culture can change. When I was in medical school, they taught us that homosexuality was a psychiatric disease. If you say that now, in fact, you better cut it off because they might not. One time I said something like that, they cut off my YouTube. I'm serious. Ask for the AV. Anyway, let me behave. the whole message, he said, Pastor, the message didn't go play on YouTube. I said, I know why. I know it's because I said that thing. Just cut it off. I know my peeps. Praise the Lord. Culture cannot be accurate because if it is, it will not always be changing. And if I base my life on culture, I will be unstable because what was right yesterday is not right today. Now, it's okay for me to base my clothes on culture. Amen. Just 10 years ago, the pants that were raining, they were the torn-up pants and they were sweeping the floor. So one day I saw my son, he was wearing the pants, he's afraid of the ground. I said, Asha, what's up? Is that the new style? I said, yeah, dad, that's the new style. So you know what I did? I went to change all my pants. So I'm not belittling culture. But there are some things that I cannot afford. I can go to the hair, but let me. But there are some things that are too valuable. They are too important. They are too crucial for me to build on culture because culture is ever changing. And what is ever changing cannot be the yardstick for everlasting truth. Tradition, the way we've always done it. If I follow tradition, I will not be here today. I will say that my father was Muslim. His daddy was Muslim. His daddy was Muslim. And so I'm going to relate to God the way we've always done it in my family. But I must understand that as much as I adored my dad, he was my hero growing up, he's still human, and every human can be wrong, even if sincere. Are you hearing what I'm saying to you? Just because we did it that, or we always did it one way, does not mean that's the way we must always do it. Some of the reasons why we do something is because we didn't even know why it was done that way. There's this popular story of, years ago, grandma, you know, the fish, the pots they had could not take the head and the tail of the fish. So they used to cut the head and tail so that it would fit the pot. Okay. So mama saw that. Okay. And did not know why. And cut and fit it. Then daughter saw that and cut. Then the fourth generation gets, ah, well, why? Said, ah, because that's the way mama did it. I said, why? So mama said, why? By the time they finally got to great grandma, she said, ah. Is because in those days, the pot we had could not cook, you know, too small. They were too small. That's why. Praise the Lord. Which does not have to be done today because we have bigger pots by technology. So that's the problem when we insist we have to do it the way it's always done. Because the way it's always done does not mean it's right today. Say amen, somebody. The way... Logic. The problem with logic is that logic is the product of intelligence. And our IQs in these rooms are different. Not because we're more important or less important, less valuable. That is because that's the way God created it to be. No loving parent predicate relationship with their children based on their IQ. No longer, I'm only going to have relationship with my child that gets an A. The one that has Down syndrome, I'm not going to have any relationship with him. This is the problem with highly intelligent people. They cannot understand faith because they are always trying to intellectualize God. That's why the Bible says, ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. God has not put the message of faith at the mercy of intelligence. You know why? Because he loves every one of us. He has put the message of faith at the mercy of faith. Without faith, not IQ. Without faith, not intelligence. Without faith, not logic. Without faith, not reasoning. It is impossible to please God. So that every one of us, no matter who you are, where you came from, how you were brought up, you can have a relationship with God as long as you're willing to believe him. They can only nourish my soul. They can only enlighten me, improve my imaginative process, makes me more aware in knowledge. And yes, they can develop my decision-making capacity. And all of that is wonderful. I'm not belittling that. But the Bible is much more. It's a spirit book. It not only nourishes my soul, it nourishes my spirit. Because it is full of spirit life. That is why when I expose myself to it, I become more like Jesus. And I become more equipped to do what Jesus wants me to. Oh, God. Yes, I do. Yes, I do. Yes, I do. Because they are spirit and they are life. So that is why the child of God must, number one, receive the word of God. That's what James told us. He said, putting away all filthiness and overflowing of wickedness. We read that last week. Putting away filthiness and if I start on that, I'll never finish. Because God will never ask you to put away stuff if it's not because you have it. Oh, you didn't get that. You see, if you use Sunday morning to judge church people, you'll miss it. One person said, if Hollywood needs extra help at great cost, they need to come to church. At no cost. Little cost. Little cost. Praise the Lord. Because we come, the nails are not ours. The hair is, the smell, let me behave myself and be nice. So you're making a mistake if you try to use church to adjudicate, to judge truth. That's why you have to look at the word of God. Because the word of God will identify every hypocrite. The word of God will tell you how people are, regardless of how they are. We are acting. God will tell you the real deal. So James said, put away, lay aside all filthiness and overflow of wickedness to let you and I know that no matter how pious or holy anybody looks in church, everybody has got some filth and everybody's got some wickedness. Praise the Lord. So James said, in order for us to be what God wants, we've got to put that away. We got to put it aside. The mess, the filth, the wickedness that resides in every one of us. And receive with meekness. Thank you for putting it up. Lay apart all filthiness to a future of naughtiness. The original King James is, it says, the overflow of wickedness. And receive with meekness the engrafted word, which is able to save your souls. So God's word must be received, number one. God's word must be read, number two. You got to read it. You got to read it. You got to read it. Because it's imperative for you to know it in order to pass the tests of life. No matter how much I prayed when I was in medical school, and I fasted, and I went to church, and I worshiped, deep worship, and I prostrated on the floor, and nothing wrong with all of that. If I did not read my books, I will fail every test. Child of God, if you do not read the word, you will be handicapped in passing the tests of life that the world and the devil throws our way. Say amen, somebody. God's word must be received. God's word must be read. God's word must be researched. It means you have to study it, not just read it. Like you're reading a newspaper. No. You have to study it. That's what the scripture said. Study to show yourself approved, a workmanship under God, rightly dividing the word of truth. Because in order for you to appropriately divide it, you've got to study it. You've got to compare scriptures with scriptures. Remember what it said here. All of that comes by study. God's word must be remembered. You cannot remember it if you have not read it. You cannot remember it if you have not studied it. It is remembering God's word that helps us in the hour of need. When the devil comes, listen to me, your educational status and how cute you are, how talented you are, how brilliant you are, it's not going to help you. It could not help Jesus. The only thing that helps, it is written. It is written. When Satan, at the deep night hour, when he infuses your head with terrible thoughts and he makes your head so heavy, just giving you all kind of fairy darts, thoughts. You know how wicked the devil can be, telling you this and you're not going to make it and you're going to die and COVID is going to kill you. You're going to die lonely. You're going to die wicked. Baby, you got to know the word and tell the devil back, I will live and not die. Only God's word can help you. No matter how famous you are or how fortunate you are, no matter how much money or fame you got, no matter how proficient you are, when the devil attacks you, the only defense you have is the word of God. This is the reason why famous and wealthy people kill themselves, because it is a mental battle. And sometimes when
we are so thankful for the opportunity to be able to come to your home, your office, or wherever it is you're viewing this broadcast. Now, if you don't know Jesus, can I pray with you? Just say this simple prayer after me. Say, Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Come and be my Lord. I receive you today. In Jesus' name. Amen. If you've prayed that prayer for the first time, please call to let us know. Our phone number is on the screen. We would love to pray with you. Or if you want us to pray with you concerning anything, we would love to agree with you in prayer. But be kind to go onto our website, call into our church office. Let us hear from you. We would love to pray with you. Additionally, if the message has been a blessing to you and you want the message in its entirety, for a small donation to the ministry, we will rush the CD or the DVD to you. Call in, let us know, we'll get it down to you.
And if you're ever in the Houston area, we would love to have you fellowship with us at Grace International Church. Look forward to seeing you.
And remember these words from Romans chapter 5 verse 17. The B part says, and we who have received abundance of grace and the free gift of righteousness shall rule and reign in Christ Jesus. We will be back at this same station at this same time next week to bring you more word from the Lord.